Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our daily current affair MCQs based series, in which what we do, we daily discuss 10 MCQs based upon the current affairs of the day. So today is 3rd September, so let's see what are the questions for today. The first question is, PJ Nayak committee seen in news recently is related to A. to review governance of Board of Banks, B. financial inclusion, C. monetary policy transmission, D. none of the above. So friends, there is no point of saying that I think the answer is A, because obviously it is shown on your screen that the answer is A. So it is basically this PJ Nayak committee is it was set up in 2014 to review the review governance of boards of banks. So it was constituted by RBI. So it was chaired by PJ Nayak, the former CEO and chairman of Axis Bank. So objective was to review the regulatory compliance requirements of boards of banks in the country, to evaluate what can be rationalized and where requirements need to be enhanced, and examine workings of the boards of banks and other related matters. So you can read about these details in the PDF itself. So why it was set up? It basically when the in nationalized banks, the governments own more than 50% of the share, which gives it majority voting rights. Because of this, the government can interfere in boards of such banks and appoint inefficient people to the boards. So that is, the appointment of members might not be based on merit. So this leads to overall efficiency and scams such as syndicate bank scam. So PJ Nayak committee was introduced to bring reforms in the board of banks. So governance boards of the banks. So basically recommendations were repeal the Bank Nationalization Act 1970-1980 and SBI Act and SBI Subsidiaries Act. So this is because these acts require the government to have above 50% share in the banks. So after the above acts are repealed, government should set up bank investment company as a holding company or a core investment company. So the government to transfer its share in the banks to this BIC. So this would become the parent holding company of all these national banks, which would become subsidiaries. So there would be bank investment company that would act as a holding company. So as a result of this, all the public sector banks would become limited banks. So BIC will be autonomous and have the power to appoint the board of directors and make other policy decisions. So until the BIC is formed, a temporary body called the Banks Board Bureau will be formed to do the functions of BIC. So once BIC is formed, BBB, Banks Board Bureau, will be dissolved. So Banks Board Bureau will advise on appointments to the boards, banks, chairman and other executive directors. Let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to the post of governor. First, the governor enjoys security of tenure for the period of 5 years. Second, according to the constitution, the president should consult chief minister of the state before appointing the governor to the state. So which of the above statements is correct? Let me tell you friends that both of these statements are incorrect. The governor doesn't enjoy any security of tenure, and there is no such precondition that the president must consult the chief minister of the state before appointing the governor to the state. So the answer is D, that is neither one and nor two. So references you can see, check in Indian Polity book of Lakshmikant. Then his third question, consider the following statements related to foreigners tribunals. First, it is appointed by the respective high courts after consultation with the state government. Second, only retired judges of the high court are appointed as members of the tribunal. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you friends that both of these statements are incorrect. So for foreigners tribunal, they are not appointed by the high courts, but they are now in the amended foreign tribunals order of 1964. These foreigners tribunal are appointed by the respective district magistrates to decide upon a person who is residing illegally in India to decide upon his case, that whether he is a citizen of India or not. So answer is D. So MHA has abandoned this amended this order 1964. So changes are that now district magistrates have been empowered to set up these tribunals in all the states and UTs to decide whether a person staying illegally in India is a foreigner or not. So amended foreigners tribunal order 2019 also empowers individuals to approach the tribunal. So earlier only the cases were referred by the central government, but now these foreigner tribunals can be constituted by district magistrate, and can an individual whose citizenship is questioned can also approach the tribunal. So amended order also allows district magistrate to refer individuals who haven't filed claims against their exclusion from NRC to the tribunals to decide if they are foreigners or not. So that is a very important point. This, please note that. So if in case, for example, recently on 31st August, NRC was released, and there were certain persons who were excluded, approximately 19 lakh people who were excluded from the NRC. So some were out of these 19 lakh, some were those who haven't filed their claims against their exclusion from NRC. So it is not that they will be automatically considered foreigners, but rather their cases will also be referred to the tribunals to decide if they are foreigners or not. So as such, the exclusion from NRC doesn't amount to a person being declared as foreigners until then, unless this foreigner tribunals decides upon that. So current practice was that these tribunals were vested only with the center, and 1964 order on constitution of tribunals said the central government may by order refer the question as to whether a person is not a foreigner within the meaning of Foreigners Act 1946 to a tribunal to be constituted for the purpose for its opinion. So let's move on to the next question. Next is the Golden Triangle Tourism Circuit comprises of first Delhi, second Meerut, third Jaipur, fourth Agra. So we have to choose that which of these statements is correct. So let me tell you, friends, that the Golden Triangle Tourism Circuit comprises of Delhi, Jaipur and Agra. So no, yes. So Delhi, Jaipur and Agra. So answer is A. So India's Golden Triangle is a basically tourist circuit which connects the national capital Delhi and then Agra and then Jaipur. So please note it is very important. So Golden Triangle is so called because of the triangular shape formed by the locations of New Delhi, Agra and Rajasthan. So here you can see this is New Delhi, and here is Agra, that is in UP. And then there is Jaipur. So this is the Golden Triangle. So New Delhi, Jaipur and Agra are connected by it. Next is the longest electrified train tunnel is in state of A. Andhra Pradesh, B. Tamil Nadu, C. Maharashtra, D. Karnataka. So friends, the answer is A, that is Andhra Pradesh. So India's longest electrified train rail tunnel was recently inaugurated in Andhra Pradesh. So it is the longest electrified rail tunnel, that is 6.7 kilometer long tunnel, and basically it is electrified, and it was constructed at a cost of rupees 437 crore and connects Cherlopalli and Rapuru. So please note this, it is very important. So it is the longest electrified tunnel, which is in Andhra Pradesh. So it connects Cherlopalli and Rapuru, and it is 6.7 km long. Next is, consider the following statements related to Chishti order of Sufi movement. The Chishti order was established in India by Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti in 1192. Second, the Mughal ruler Akbar constructed the tomb for Chishti in Ajmer after his death. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that the answer is first only. That is, first is correct. That is, it was established by Moinuddin Chishti, Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti in 1192. So the answer is A. So Chishti order were the sands of this order. Basically, the chief was Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti. They basically lived in poverty and led a hermit life. So they did not accept state service. So this order is primarily followed in Afghanistan and in Indian subcontinent. So basically, please note this, that now this order is basically prominent in Afghanistan and in Indian subcontinent. It was established by Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti in 1192, shortly after the death of Prithviraj Chauhan. So he died in 1236, and his tomb in Ajmer was constructed by Ghiyasuddin Khalji of Malwa. So please note that the tomb of the Moinuddin Chishti was not developed by Akbar, but rather it was made by your Ghiyasuddin Khalji, you can also call it, of Malwa. So please note it, this is very important. So obviously, because you can imagine that when it was constituted in 1192, but Akbar came in the 16th century, and he was there in 16th century. So obviously that cannot be the answer. So obviously then Khwaja Mohinuddin Chishti was the founder, and Khalji of Malwa made his tomb, and then Muhammad bin Tughlaq visited the tomb, and later it came under state management during Mughal ruler Akbar's reign. So one of the notable Sufi saints was Khwaja Qutbuddin Bakhtiar Kaki, who organized work in Delhi, and contemporary Delhi Sultanate ruler was Iltutmish, who was deeply devoted to Chishti order. So please note that Iltutmish was in favor of Chishti order. So another names were Nizamuddin Aulia, and he adopted yogic breathing exercises so much so that yogis called him Siddh or Perfect. So Aulia's famous disciple was Amir Khusro, who is called the father of Qawwali and parrot of India, and introduced the ghazal style of India. And after the death of Nasruddin Chirage Delhi in the 14th century, the Chishti's order declined. And next question is, consider the following taxes and their purposes during the period of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. First, Kharaj land tax. Second, Zakht tax on Muslim property. Third, Jizya booty captured during war. Fourth, Kham levied on non-Muslim subjects for protection. So friends, clearly let me tell you that third cannot be correct, because Jizya was basically a tax levied on Hindu pilgrims. So this could not be the third, could not be correct. So obviously C and D in that case is eliminated, and also then B is also eliminated, and only option that you are left with is A, that is 1 and 2 only. So Kharaj was a kind of land tax. So Firoz Shah Kotla Stadium is said to be renamed Arun Jaitley Stadium after the former finance minister. So the stadium took its name from the 14th century fortress Firoz Shah Tughlaq. So about Firoz Shah Tughlaq, he was born in 1309 and ascended the throne of Delhi after the demise of his cousin Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So he was the third ruler of Tughlaq dynasty that ruled over from 1320 to 1412. Tughlaq was in power from 1351 to 1388. So he was the one who started the imposition of jizya. So he provided the principle of inheritance to the armed forces. So please note this, that Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Firoz Shah Tughlaq was the first, and who levied this jizya for the first time. And then he was after his demise, Muhammad bin Tughlaq came into power. So he was third ruler, and then he provided the principle of inheritance to the armed forces, where the officers were permitted to rest and send their children in army in their place. However, they were not paid in real money but by land. So the British called him the father of irrigation department because of the many gardens and canals that he built. So contributions are Diwan-e-Khairat, that he established office for charity, and then Diwan-e-Bandgan, department of slave, established sarais, rest houses for the benefits of merchants and other travelers. So adopted Iktadari framework and established four new towns, that is Firozabad, Fatehabad, Jaunpur and Hisar. So he established hospitals known as Darul Shifa, Bimaristan, Ristan or Shifa Khana. So he constructed canals from Yamuna to the city of Hisar, Satluj to Ghaggar, Ghaggar to Firozabad, Mandvi and Sidmore Hills to Hansi in Haryana. So taxes that were imposed were Kharaj, Zakht, Kham and Jizya. Kharaj was basically land tax, which was equal to 1/10 of the produce of the land, and Zakht was 2.5% tax on the property realized from the Muslims. So Kham was 1/5 of the booty captured. 4/5 was left for the soldiers, and jizya was levied on non-Muslim subjects, particularly the Hindus. So women and children were, however, exempted from the tax. Also levied other taxes were other taxes like irrigation tax, garden tax, octroi tax and sale tax. So please note it, friends, that there were specific tax for Hindus as well as Muslims. So for Hindus it was jizya, and for Muslim it was zakht, that is 2.5% on the property of the Muslims. And then Kharaj land tax, and Kham is 1/5 of the booty captured. So next is, second is Samudrayan project seen in news recently. A is related to deep ocean mission for mining rare metals. B, nuclear submarine project. C, ocean biodiversity conservation mission. D, none of the above. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that the answer is A, that is deep ocean mission for mining rare metals. So India has to undertake deep ocean mining with Samundrayan project. So about this is that it is a project of Ministry of Earth Sciences for the deep ocean mining for rare minerals, and it proposes to send men into deep sea in a submersible vehicle for ocean studies. So project is expected to become a reality by 2021-22. So the project has been undertaken by National Institute of Ocean Technology. So significance is that if in case it is successful, India will join the League of Developed Nations in exploring the minerals from ocean. So it could also lead to India being the first developing country to undertake such a project. So this is about your something about further information. Now let's move to the next question. Automatic exchange of information seen in news recently between India and which country? A. United Kingdom, B. Switzerland, C. France, D. Malaysia. So the answer, friends, is Switzerland. So automatic exchange of information regime between Switzerland and India kicked off from September 1, 2019. Under the mechanism, India will start receiving information on all financial accounts held by the Indian residents in the Switzerland for the year 2018. So what does it mean for India, and how will it change the exchange of information? This is not a new measure. In fact, 2016 such a measure was taken that in which India and Switzerland had signed on information sharing link on bank accounts, which was to come in effect from September 2019. So step is likely to shed more light on the wealth the Indians have stashed away in Swiss bank accounts for so long governed by strict local rules of secrecy. So this is about your ninth question. Let's move on to the next question. Next is your tenth question. That is, Munich agreement seen in news recently is related to A. First World War II related agreements, B. is formation of European Union, C. NATO related, and D. is none of the above. So friends, let me tell you that the answer is A. That is World War II related argument. So it is often labeled as an action of as the action of appeasement of Nazi Hitler, that is Nazi Germany. So basically September 1, 1939, so war was declared, and Great Britain and France, which had assaulted to Poland, which had assured help to Poland, declared war on Germany and its allies 2 days later. So the beginning of war exposed the world to the folly of the Munich Agreement, because Munich Agreement was signed among the Germany, France and Italy and Great Britain. So basically, Czechoslovakia, the country whose region was about to be annexed and was not official party to the agreement. So it was forced to agree to the deal under pressure of Great Britain, France, which had a military alliance with the country. So then agreement allowed for secession of Germany to the Sudetenland. So German occupation was to be done in 4 stages. So this was basically the Munich Agreement, but however it failed drastically, because it sent the message that yes, these extremist elements or the extremist governments can claim legitimacy after such type of deals, because they use such agreements and then they claim the territories of others, and they don't accept the limits on their power. So this is all about, friends, today's discussion about daily MCQ series. So if you like the questions, if you like the video, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And lastly, friends, if you want to get the PDFs of these MCQs, you can mail us at cyes21@gmail.com, or you can also contact us at our number, that is 896892072. So this is our contact number. So if in case you are interested to join, then you can check our description box. So link will also be provided in the description box for the subscription. So obviously there will be a minimum fee for the subscription, which has been kept 99 rupees per month. So this amount has been kept for the purpose of your affordability as well as for the purpose of our motivation. So do ensure that you subscribe to these MCQs and get their PDFs. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. And lastly, friends, one more thing is that we also have a Telegram channel on which you can join. And on this Telegram channel, we update all our initiatives that we are running on different platforms. So to get a kind of to get an idea about all these things, you can